Primary immunodeficiencies are a group of, until now, more than 400 diseases that are genetically characterized. And the incidence of primary immunodeficiencies is not very well defined. Currently, one estimates that probably 1 in 2,500 might suffer from one of the more than 400 different diseases. And of course, nowadays, genetic diagnosis is playing an important role. And for example, we have a collaboration with someone in Iran, and there, as a first step in the diagnosis, they use genetics, whole exome sequencing. And because of the high level of consanguinity, they can already identify, in 60% of the cases, the genetic cause, which is high. In Belgium, for example, we only have something like 20% of the cases. The difference is, in Iran, they do not have access to immunological testing, and that's why they directly go to genetic testing, at least in that lab. And we, as I told you, we collaborate with them, and the first case I will show is a patient that we did in this collaboration, that we worked out in that collaboration. But patients with primary immunodeficiencies, they mainly suffer from increased susceptibility to infections. More frequent infections, more severe infections, unusual pathogens. So when you have such a patient, please think of a primary immunodeficiency. For example, if you have a patient with liver abscess, consider the possibility. Even invasive infections, one thinks that 1 in 3 of patients with an invasive infection, there might be an underlying immune defect. And I will start with a case in which there was an abnormal reaction to vaccination. And as you know, we have some live attenuated viral vaccines. And in some rare cases, you see that giving the vaccine results in a life-threatening disease. Some are known. For example, life-threatening disease after poliovirus vaccination occurs in patients with agammaglobulinemia. Rotavirus vaccine can cause a life-threatening infection in patients with severe combined immunodeficiencies. There are also cases described in which the vaccine MMR, measles, mumps, rubella, causes a severe measles infection. And there are some genetic defects known, such as defects in interferon alpha receptor 2, STAT1, STAT2, IRF7, IRF9. But as you see, this is only a limited group of really genetic causes of abnormal reaction to vaccination. And I will present you two cases. And the first case is the patient from Iran. He, the boy, after receiving the MMR vaccine, he developed severe encephalitis. His sister, also after vaccination with MMR, died because of encephalitis and because of the reaction to the vaccine. And then there is another case from Brazil, a girl who developed viscerotropic disease after yellow fever vaccination. And both cases, the question was made, what is the cause? And whole exome sequencing was performed, and we found a defect in the receptor for interferon alpha, the receptor 1, IFNAR1 it is called. And the defect was a homozygous mutation at the splice site in the Iranian patient, and it was a compound heterozygous mutation in the patient from Brazil. One of these mutations was very close to the Iranian patient, affecting the splice site, and the other one resulted in a stop codon. So this patient was worked out in Belgium, and this one in New York. So the receptor for interferon alpha, the receptor 1, it forms a complex with the receptor 2, and it is activated by type 1 interferons, interferon alpha, interferon beta. After activation, you get phosphorylation of STAT1 and STAT2. They will form a heterodimer, and this heterodimer will enter into the nucleus and will bind to an interferon stimulated region that then will activate transcription of ISG, interferon-stimulated genes. These are genes that are important in the defense against viral infections. In addition to that, you have the receptor to interferon gamma. And when this receptor is activated, you get phosphorylation of STAT1, you get a dimer of STAT1, and this then will bind to some other regions, the gamma activated sequences, and this also will result in enhanced transcription of, again, these interferon-stimulated genes in order to defend ourselves against viral infections. So the first thing that we did is we confirmed by Sanger sequencing the mutations. It was confirmed. And this is the population genetics of the variants. The variants that we found in these patients are private. This means they have not been described in any database. And the pathogenicity of these variants is considered high. This is a score that reflects the pathogenicity. Well, this score is high above the cutoff score of pathogenicity. So we have private variants that are predicted to be pathogenic. So the effect on the protein level is that the splice mutations, we studied it, we found that it resulted in a deletion of exon 6 with a frame shift and a stop codon at position 228, which means that a large part of the extracellular region of the receptor is deleted. So this part is deleted, and you can imagine that it will affect the function. And in the Brazilian patient, this was combined with another stop mutation also in this extracellular region. So we then could show that the mRNA levels in the patients for IFNAR1 was lower than normal. And then we, of course, because this has never been described, such a mutation in IFNAR1, we had to prove that indeed the function of this receptor is affected. And what did we do? So we stimulated the receptor by adding interferon alpha and interferon beta. And we would expect that this would affect the phosphorylation of STAT1 and STAT2, first of all, and that also in the end, it would affect the transcription of these interferon-stimulating genes. On the other hand, when we stimulate with interferon gamma, there would be no effect. This is what we would expect. And this is indeed what we found. So here, this is a Western blot after stimulation of the fibroblasts of the patients, for example, after stimulation with interferon alpha. So we see that in a control individual, there is phosphorylation of STAT1. In the father, there is phosphorylation of STAT1. In the mother, there is phosphorylation. But in the patient, no phosphorylation at all. By contrast, when we stimulate with interferon gamma, we see stimulation in the controls, the parents, and the patient. So this pathway is intact. This pathway is not intact. And in addition to that, we studied a number of controls, also diseased controls, to further confirm it. We also looked at these interferon-stimulated genes. And indeed, after stimulation with interferon alpha, these are controls, you see an increased expression of one of these genes, OAS1 here, in the controls, but not in the patient. The same after stimulation with interferon beta, but when we stimulate with interferon gamma, we see expression of these genes. Thus again, the interferon alpha pathway is affected, but not the interferon gamma pathway. And this is the same for another gene. And finally, we also infected the fibroblasts with measles, the measles virus. And what you see in a control is when you infect these cells, you see syncytia formation, this infection of the fibroblast. This is when it is not infected. When you pre-treat in a control individual the fibroblast with interferon alpha or interferon gamma, you see that the infection is cleared. In the patient, however, you see an infection in unstimulated fibroblast, but when you add interferon alpha, you do not clear the infection, but you do when you add interferon gamma. And this is two other patients, STAT2 and IFNAR2. So this confirms that this patient is unable to clear the infection through the interferon alpha pathway. We did the same. This was done in New York. They studied yellow fever infection of the fibroblast. And you get in untreated fibroblasts, the patients, you get an infection of the fibroblast, and the infection is somewhat less pronounced in the controls. But when you pre-treat with interferon alpha, the controls here really clear the infection. The patients in red do not. And finally, to really prove that the defect in the interferon alpha pathway is the cause of the disease, you can rescue by transducing with wild-type interferon alpha receptor, and then you should see that you can have again the activity. And this is when you do a transduction with empty vector, so the patient is not able to phosphorylate STAT1, but when you transduce, when you bring in wild-type interferon alpha receptor, then the patient is able again to phosphorylate STAT1. And we did the same with the transfection with the measles. So empty vector transduction, you are not able to clear the infection, but when you transduce with the wild type, you are able to clear the infection. So the conclusion, interferon alpha receptor 1 defect is indeed a new immunodeficiency with a lack in specific antiviral defense, and it also shows the potential of next generation sequencing not only to diagnose primary immune deficiencies but also to identify novel primary immunodeficiencies. And now what I want to do is, this was more a fundamental part, I now will try to give you an overview of the immunological techniques we have in the clinical lab to support the diagnosis and workup of primary immunodeficiencies. There are a lot of subgroups in the primary immunodeficiency, but the most important subgroup are the antibody deficiencies. And characteristic for an antibody deficiency is that patients really have increased susceptibility to respiratory tract infections, upper and lower airway tract infections, especially with infections with encapsulated bacteria. Indeed, in order to clear these bacteria, you need to make antibodies to the polysaccharide capsule of, for example, Streptococcus pneumoniae. So increased susceptibility to infections with encapsulated bacteria really is the hallmark of antibody deficiency. And the test that we can use, of course, we can measure or quantify the immunoglobulin levels, the subclasses, and also the immune reaction to vaccination with pneumococcal polysaccharides is also an important test. And of course, you can do B-cell immunophenotyping and the molecular studies. When you have to interpret results of antibodies, you should take into account that you should look at the age-related reference values, because especially in very young children, there is some big variation in the antibody levels in normal children, especially because you have the maternal immunoglobulins that are present during the first 6 months that disappear, and then the own antibodies come up. Immunophenotyping, B cells are CD19 positive. These are B cells, these are T cells, these are CD3 positive. Agammaglobulinemia is, let's say, the prototype of an antibody deficiency. It was first described in 1952 by Bruton, the Bruton agammaglobulinemia. So these are children when the maternal antibodies disappear, they are unable to produce their own antibodies, and they begin to have increased susceptibility to bacterial infections from 6 months onwards. This is a case, for example, this is a control. You see B cells, but these patients, no B cells at all, and no immunoglobulins. That's very typical for the Bruton's agammaglobulinemia. No B cells, no immunoglobulins. And the problem is a defect in what we call Bruton tyrosine kinase. It's a kinase that is important in the development of B cells. And we can also measure this kinase by flow cytometry. You can measure it very well in B cells, but these patients do not have B cells, so we have to measure them in monocytes. And that's a control. You see, this BTK, BTK is present in a control, but not in the patient. And this confirms the diagnosis. Common variable immunodeficiency is also antibody-related primary immunodeficiencies. It presents typically in adolescents and young adults. And of course, you have, again, this increased susceptibility to respiratory tract infections. But in addition to that, these people also suffer from autoimmunity, lymphoproliferation, granulomatous disease. In the lab, of course, you measure the antibodies. What you can also do is measure when you look at the B lymphocytes, the B lymphocytes, you can subdivide them in naive B lymphocytes. They are negative for CD20. And the memory B lymphocytes, they are positive for CD20. Well, such patients with common variable immunodeficiencies, they have diminished number of these memory B lymphocytes. And when you look further into detail in these memory B lymphocytes, you can distinguish those that are IgM and IgD positive and those that have switched to IgG or IgA, for example. Well, this subpopulation is, in most of the patients, diminished. B lymphocytes and memory B lymphocytes, this is a recent summary. You find them in approximately 25% of normal individuals of B lymphocytes, but there are many immunodeficiencies, and we will not go into detail here, in which this number of memory B lymphocytes really is clearly diminished. This means that all these genes, in one or another way, are important in the development of B cell memory. So, and you can also have patients with normal levels of immunoglobulins, normal subclasses, but they even suffer from increased susceptibility to these encapsulated bacteria. And what people are doing then is, as a test, as an evaluation, you give a vaccine, the pneumovax vaccine, in which you give a vaccine with these polysaccharides, and you measure the response to these polysaccharides. And there are some international guidelines that say that you should have at least a post-vaccination antibody levels that is higher than 1.3 milligram per liter for at least 50% of the tested serotypes. And you should have a fold increase. This means your post-vaccination antibody level compared to your pre-vaccination antibody level should be at least 2 times. So we have several pneumococcal vaccines. And Pneumovax or Pneumo 23 contains 23 serotypes. And these serotypes are not conjugated to a protein. And in addition, you have the conjugated vaccines in which the polysaccharides are conjugated to a protein. These conjugated polysaccharide vaccines, they elicit a T-cell dependent immune response. Whereas these unconjugated ones, they elicit a T-cell independent response. Mainly B-cells will react. Just to situate it a little bit, in Belgium, for example, the first conjugated vaccine was introduced in 2004. And since then, all children receive this conjugated vaccine as part of their routine vaccination scheme. But, for example, serotype 4 is a serotype that is present in all the vaccines, the unconjugated and the conjugated vaccine. Well, what I'm going to show you here is the immune response to serotype 4 in children aged 2 to 5 years old, And this is pre-vaccination antibody levels to this serotype 4 and the post-vaccination antibody levels. And this is in children, this was done before 2004, that had not received the conjugated vaccine. So they were vaccinated with the unconjugated vaccine, pre-vaccination, post-vaccination. These are children born after 2004, and all these children, they had received the conjugated vaccine, and then, as part of the evaluation of their immune response to the unconjugated vaccine, they received the unconjugated vaccine. And you can clearly see that in these children, here, the antibody levels post-vaccination are significantly higher than in the children that had not received the conjugated vaccine. What does it mean? So these children, because they received the conjugated vaccine, they had developed memory, because this is a T-cell dependent response, the conjugated vaccine, conjugated to a protein. They have developed memory, and when later on they received the unconjugated vaccine, they were able to mount a really high antibody response, higher than children that did not develop this memory. And that's why when we now evaluate the immune response to the pneumo 23, we only measure antibodies to serotypes that are not contained in any of the conjugated vaccines, that are really unique for the unconjugated vaccine, because this is the only way to really evaluate the immune response to a T-cell independent response. So, and this is some of the data that we have for serotype 8, for example, and this is all the analysis that we have done so far. We see that there is no change that is related to the age up to the age 30. This is the post-vaccination. This is for serotype 8. This is for serotype 9. There is a small decline in function of age. And this is for serotype 15B. And you see serotype-dependent differences, because for this serotype, in children, the antibody response is much lower than in adults. So this should be taken into account, that the serotype-specific response is, or the antibody response to polysaccharides is serotype-specific and is also age-dependent. Based on all these data we had, we were able, by using a mathematical approach in which we could fit this, and you can do so, this is a Bhattacharya analysis, it's somewhat mathematical, but by fitting that, you could kind of define a cutoff value, and the cutoff value that we could define was 1.38, which is very close to the international accepted cutoff value for the antibody response to polysaccharides. Then I would like to say something about the hyper-IgM syndrome. In hyper-IgM, patients mount antibodies, and the first antibody we mount are IgM antibodies, and then normally when in a second contact with the antigen, you switch from IgM to IgG or IgA. Well, and this, in order to make that switch, you need an interaction between CD40 ligand and CD40. And when you have mutations in these proteins, then you are unable to switch, and these patients have high levels of IgM and very low levels of IgG or IgA. And of course, we can also study that in the lab. And what you do, the defects in CD40 ligand are the most frequent defects that underlie hyper-IgM. Well, you can stimulate the T cells of the patients, and normally you should see expression of CD40 ligand. This is a control, a nice expression. This is a patient, no expression. So when we saw that, we sequenced the gene, and indeed, we could find a mutation. So typically, hyper-IgM with mutation in CD40 ligand. We had another patient, and this is again a control, nice expression of CD40 ligand, and this patient, no expression at all. So we thought we again have the diagnosis, a mutation in CD40 ligand. We sequenced CD40 ligand, but no mutation at all. We resequenced it, no mutation. Then we looked at the messenger RNA levels, and there was no mRNA that we could see. So then we thought, oh, probably there is a problem in the promoter. So we sequenced the promoter, and indeed, there was a mutation in the promoter. We then had to demonstrate that this mutation in the promoter really affects expression of CD40 ligand. There we collaborated with a group in the United States that could construct the promoter in a reporter system, and they were able to really show that this promoter of this patient was not effective express the protein. And a final case, the clinician said, I think this is a patient with hyper-IgM, high IgM levels, low IgG levels. So we tested for expression of CD40 ligand. This is the patient, and there was an expression of CD40 ligand. I said, no problem with CD40 ligand. But the clinician insisted, yeah, there must be something, there must be something. The problem in this patient was the patient expressed the CD40 ligand, but it was not functional. When we tested the interaction of CD40 ligand with CD40, which is important, this interaction, then we see that there was no binding of CD40 in this patient, and in the control there was. So since that patient, we now systematically also study the interaction of CD40 ligand with CD40 when we get such a question. So this for the B cells and problems with B cells. Then you have the T cells, and patients with problems with the T cells, mainly are young patients. They are severely sick, severe combined immunodeficiencies. And these patients typically have recurrent infections with opportunistic pathogens, such as Candida, rotavirus, and so on. There is a failure to thrive, chronic diarrhea, and recurrent infections, opportunistic pathogens, but also bacteria and fungi. What can we do in the lab? Of course, you should measure and quantify the whole white blood cells. Again, important to compare with age-matched controls. And you're going to find, if you see lower levels, it's important to immunophenotyping, look at the T-cell subsets, T-cell proliferation evaluation. You can also do a TRAC analysis. And some specific antibody markers. One of the most frequent causes of such SCID is a deficiency in the gamma chain, a common gamma chain of cytokine receptors. And this common gamma chain is part of the cytokine receptor for IL-2, 4, 7, 9, 15, and 21. IL-7 is important for the development of T cells, IL-15 for the development of NK cells. So what you expect if you have a problem with this common gamma chain is no T cells, no NK cells, because IL-7 and IL-15. And so this doing a immunophenotyping and quantifying the lymphocyte subsets can help you to have an idea of the underlying molecular defect. I mentioned this common gamma chain. You have no T cells, no NK cells. If you have a problem with T cells, B cells, and NK cells, your underlying defect is something that affects all cells, for example, a metabolic disease, adenosine deaminase deficiencies. When you see only diminished T cells and B cells, but normal NK cells, then the problem is something to do with the rearrangement of your B cell receptor and T cell receptors, because these processes are quite similar between B cells and T cells. This recombination activity and the enzymes responsible for this recombination activity can be mutated, and these are the recombination activating genes. So when you see such a phenotype, then think of defects in this gene. When you see no T cells, but you see B and NK cells, then you have a problem with the IL-7 receptor. When you only see diminished CD4 cells, then you should think of MHC2 deficiency. MHC2 deficiency is present on CD4 cells, and when it is absent, you will have diminished CD4 cell. Thus, again, having an idea of your lymphocyte subsets really can guide your molecular testing. Some examples, a patient with a RAC mutation, no B cells, no T cells, but NK cells. This recombination activity is affected. This is a patient with this metabolic defect, adenosine deaminase deficiency, no B cells, no T cells, no NK cells. And this is a case that that we had last week in our lab, and I thought I can show it. This is, again, a SCID case. You see here there are B cells, CD19 cells, but almost no T cells, and the NK cells almost absent. But what is typically here, when you look at these T cells, you see that they are, this is now gated on the T cells, they are activated. They express HLA-DR, and normally, a young child, neonatus, the only T cells such a child has are naive T cells. Naive T cells are positive for CD45RA. Well, here the T cells that you see, none of them is naive. What we are seeing here, this is maternal engraftment. The T cells that we see here are T cells from the mother. This is an example of an HLA-DR deficiency. Normally, HLA-DR is expressed on B cells and on monocytes. Well, this is a case with no expression on B cells and no expression on monocytes. So this is diagnostic of HLA-DR deficiency. These patients typically have severe respiratory and gastrointestinal tract infections. Neutrophils, when you have a defect in your neutrophils, you have again another set of clinical presentations, and mainly recurrent bacterial and importantly fungal infections of the skin, the lymph nodes, the bone, the liver and the lung. The PIDs associated with that, congenital neutropenia or cyclic neutropenia, leukocyte adhesion deficiency of chronic granulomatous disease. In the lab, of course, we're going to do a leukocyte count, a bone marrow analysis to see whether there is a potential maturation stop. You can study adhesion molecules. I will come back to that. And importantly, the oxidative burst. Neutrophils, in order to kill the pathogen, they have a mechanism. We call it the oxidative burst. And the oxidative burst, you generate reactive oxygen species that kill the bacteria. And when there is a defect with that killing, we have a disease called chronic granulomatous disease. Clinical presentation, liver, abscesses of the liver and the bone. With some selected organisms, such as Aspergillus species, Staphylococcus aureus, Serratia nocardia. So it's quite specific. You also see granulomas in the patients with poor wound healing. And we have a good test in the lab to make the diagnosis. And I will show some examples in a minute. The molecular defects are well characterized. It is our defects in the NADPH oxidase complex. And you have an X-linked form, which is the most frequent one, in which your phagocyte oxidase GP91 is affected. And you have some other forms that are less frequent. And this is a typical example of evaluation of this oxidative burst. What you do is you stimulate your neutrophils and you look and you, let's say, add to that a what we call dehydrorhodamine. And dehydrorhodamine, when the oxidative burst works well, it will transform into rhodamine, which gives a color. And you see, before stimulation, you have no signal, and after stimulation, you have a very clear signal. This is a patient with CGD, and you see, you do not see the shift that you see in the controls, so there is no oxidative burst. And this is an X-linked disease. You only find it in boys. So when you analyze the mother, you see part of the neutrophils or affected and part have a good oxidative burst. When you see that, you really can make the diagnosis of chronic granulomatous disease. We do not make that diagnosis frequently, but every time that we make it, the clinicians are really very happy because they really can start their treatment based on this kind of assay. And such patients nowadays are also transplanted. And you see this is before transplantation, no oxidative burst, and this is after transplantation, you really again gained oxidative burst. And this is the last thing I'm going to say. There is another condition, the leukocyte adhesion deficiency. The problem is you have leukocytes. They are functionally active. The problem is that they are unable to adhere to the wall of the blood vessels and to enter into the tissue. So they are not able to reach the site of infection. And typically, when you have such a disease, you will see high amounts of leukocytes in the blood because the body wants to produce leukocytes, but they are unable to go to the infection site. Leukocytosis is very typical here. And I think I will finish here because the time is up. There are still other kinds of primary immunodeficiencies, all with a very specific lab approach, but because of the time, I think I will stop here.